faces? How is that? Well, it's thanks to the Mayo, which you can see on Alex's arm, which allows him to perform gesture recognition. And using that handy dandy gesture, we activated some Arduinos over Wi-Fi. Actually, over my tethered cellular network, which activated the Keurig and is now brewing a delicious cup of coffee.
Yeah.
All without a single touch.
This was our first hack ever. We got here. It was like 6 o'clock. Realized that our idea wasn't so great. Found the Keurig machine sitting on the floor, and now we have this.
So. Next up, we have BuzzChain. Following them, we'll have a ball game against the CPU. And after that, Encabulator. Come up and get on deck ready to present. While they set up, I'd like to tell a little more about the Keurig team, because they have been really hilarious the whole time. They're a team of computer science majors that didn't have a bunch of experience with hardware. The idea that they originally came with didn't work, so they started playing with this broken Keurig machine we have. This is actually a machine that HackNY donated to NYU many years ago. It finally broke and has just been sort of sitting around ever since. They didn't know anything about circuitry or hardware coming in, and they really cut up their fingers trying to open it before they got real tools. But then they spent the whole night working with people who came in to help them, working through the whole night and getting the thing working. And I think they made something really awesome. So congratulations on doing something totally new. Great. This is so in the spirit of the hackathon and exactly the kind of thing we look for. Do you have something to put on the projector? Or are you?
We do.
Okay, go.
Chain is basically every time you refresh your page, it will generate a new BuzzFeed article for you. So we're analyzing hundreds of BuzzFeed pages using the BuzzFeed API, and we'll bring them through Markov chains. So the title is going to be always randomly generated. Each list in the all the entries in the list are randomly generated. The images aren't; they're placeholder images. We wanted to do something to clarify it for a lot of images relating to the descriptions, so we can pull that off in time. So let's do a quick test. So let's refresh the page. Title is undefined. 21 times the growing up, this reporter was bitten by a mob of kangaroos, and it was an HBCU. So number one, kids starting high school this year are the movies that made him a horror legend. That's just be like. So you guys can decide on your own also. So.
Ball game against the CPU, Encabulator, and Pythno. Ready to come up?
If you could all come to this side.
Come to the side here.
Yeah. You next? Yeah. Do you want to make sure to talk into this mic?
Oh.
Hi, everyone. We are first-time hackers from Rutgers University. And we have one more friend who did most of the coding, but unfortunately couldn't be here. He had to leave early. So we wanted to, like, all of us are, like, big-time game freaks. And we wanted to learn about this, about gaming. But it is something we don't get to study in our normal curriculum. And we thought that this is the best time to do that. So we created a game, a two-player game initially, where we have two balls and two players can play with it. And we got bored with it. So what we did, we made the second player as an AI. And initially we were kicking its ass, but later it started kicking our ass. So, but we had to now slow it down. So now we might win. And so let's see. So, I think you can't see it.
One minute.
Yeah, so the rules were simple. Like, we have, if there are hoops, we get 2 points, and if we hit the wall, we get negative points. And we use min-max model of AI. We used some brute force to calculate the nearest points, and yeah, after that, AI started beating us. So, yeah, we can't show you the whole thing. Thank you.
That was an excellent first-time hack. Next up, our two projects are by the same person. We have Encabulator and Pike. No. And don't forget to introduce yourself and tell us what school you're from.
So, hi, I'm Adam. I'm a PhD student at Columbia University. At the last Hack NY Hackathon, I entered two projects, and I won first and second place. This time, I've entered three projects. Hello, judges.
So, the first thing I've got to show you here is a project called Encabulator. So, very early this morning, I was walking back up 6th Avenue, and I couldn't find a taxi. And I was wondering, maybe I should be walking on a different avenue at this time of night. And then I realized, oh, this is a problem for New York City open data, right? So I kept thinking about this, and then I finally got to looking at these taxi data. But it turns out that each month has tens of millions of rows. And I had never used anything like Apache Mahout before, and it was 3 a.m. So then I thought, well, but are we not hackers? I mean, this is the kind of thing we do. So instead of doing this properly with some machine learning algorithm and considering all the rows, I did this ridiculous thing called Encabulator. And basically what it does is I load all of the counts of how many taxi pickups there were at a particular place and time for hourly intervals into MongoDB using update. And then in order to serve that, I use MongoDB's queries, including geographic indexing, to find the closest locations with the highest number of taxi pickups. And the result is something that looks like this. So you can see here as I scroll, it loads pretty quickly. This is all database lookups. And around this area, we're at this point, this green point, and the best place to be would be somewhere on Thompson Street over there. And the best part about this is that I haven't even loaded all the data yet. The data is still being loaded into MongoDB, and the lookups are happening at the same time, which I thought was pretty cool.
To your next project.
Okay, sorry. Thanks. So that was Encabulator. Just give me a second to switch here. All right, ready? Hello, did you miss me? All right. So I also decided to write a Python interpreter for a language Peter Norvig developed called LispPy, which is a bit like Lisp. So this interpreter is written in Python, and it's called Pythno. So you know, it's a Lisp-like language, so if I want to add 1 and 2, I do +1, 2, and I get back 3. I've added some other nice functions in addition to basic arithmetic, so I can do max 2, 3, I get back 3. I can do print 1, I get back 1. I can do cow 2, and I get a picture of a cow saying 2. And of course, it does nested operations, so I can do +1, +1, 1, and that gets me 3. 1 + 1 + 1 = 3. And I can do things like defining variables, define foo42, and then print foo, and that's 42. Now, programming is hard. So what happens if I do this and I press enter? Syntax error, I heard out there? No, because this is a nice language. No syntax errors. I detect syntax error because I wrote the parse and evaluated myself. There's a missing bracket. I automatically put in the bracket. And this doesn't work just for parentheses. I can also do +1, period. Well, period isn't a number. Let's replace it with the most sensible number. That's 0. This doesn't work just for syntax errors. It also works for runtime errors. So if I divide 1 by 0, what should I get? Divide by 0 error? No. 1 divided by 0 is infinity. So I get back the number that I have that's closest to infinity, which is 9 quintillion and something. This works for variables too. So remember, we defined foo earlier. So I can do print foo. If I do +1 foo, I've misspelled foo, but it knows that. It replaces the variable foo with the closest thing that it knows about. Which means that, and it does this iteratively over and over with these different matching rules, which means that anything I type is a valid Pythno program. Thank you.
Hey. Our next presenters will be Clara Food.
Oh, am I rude?
Totem.
No.
What? And Sunbrella. If you can all come down and get ready to present, that would be great. Come down to this side. Clara Food, where are you at?
Stephanie, she's also from Columbia University, and she's not here right now, which is unfortunate, but you got me. So we made Clara Food, which I'll just show you how it works. Basically, you're walking down the street, maybe. You see some really delicious food, or you're browsing Tumblr, and you know, you go on someone's food blog, and you see like all these desserts, or like some really ridiculous Italian food, or maybe just some simple bubble tea, and you really want it. You can put the URL here, and using you know, very fancy algorithms, some quantum entanglement, you find out, yes, I really do want bubble tea. That's what I got from that image. And it will give you some places, nearby locations in New York City for restaurants that sell whatever that image was. So basically, the idea was that if you ever see, you know, food that you really want, you maybe don't really know where it came from, or maybe like on Tumblr, you see like spaghetti, but you don't really know what kind of cuisine it is. So you would take this picture, you would take a picture of it, or you get the image URL, you put it through our search engine, which uses Clarify's API, and we trained it to recognize a whole bunch of different types of cuisine, and then uses Google Places to find locations. That's Clara Food.
Okay. Okay, so I am Cass Schiaffelli from Kent State in Ohio, and I am the maker of Totem, a password vault and generator system. So, long story short, beginning of the month, someone tried to break into my Facebook. Good news is that they didn't get in. Bad news, I use that password for like 10 other websites because I'm lazy. So I start thinking there has to be a better way to do this. Like, I just want a randomized string, like SHA-256. I can grab it. I can grab from like an extension. So being a hacker, I decided to build it. So this is a Chrome extension and mobile app. We can generate long passwords with it, create our accounts. We can also load our passwords. And how do we load our passwords? I decided to do multi-factor authentication. Doing text messages would be too easy, so I decided to do something where like you take a picture of an object, which is your totem, and I use Clarify's API to recognize that it is indeed your totem. So we'll give it a shot here. Snap the totem, which is my laptop. Wait a little bit, and it loads in. And after that, you just sign in, and there you go. Whole stack is JavaScript. I used PhoneGaps for the app, JavaScript for the extension, and I'm running a Node server with Mongo to store everything, pipe everything together.
Our next demos are Sunbrella, Assay, and President Evil from Apocalypse. Head on down to the side and get ready to demo. Thanks.
All right. You good?
You're good.
All right, time for the three-peat. So I spent this summer on the West Coast. And when I got back here, I realized that we have this thing called weather. And this weather is really annoying because it means I have to change the stuff I take with me when I go outside. I might need to take an umbrella or some sunglasses or maybe some snow boots in this city. Now, this isn't usually a problem for me because I don't go outside much. In fact, I pretty much live in my terminal. And you can tell I live in my terminal because I've got my prompt customized to display the number of unread emails and information about the Git repository and S&P 500 index fund. And I've named my computer after a mythical sword, Punty, from Beowulf. But when I occasionally do get up from my computer, I need to know that I'm taking the right equipment with me to go outside. And that's what this little snowman tells me. This little snowman says, right now it's too cold outside. You need to take a coat. And the way it knows that is because it's using forecast.io's API to get minute-by-minute climatic information on my current location. And it's pretty accurate up to the minute and then larger intervals further out. Now, this config file allows me to adjust that. So my tolerance for low temperature is 70 degrees. I want to be also told to wear sunglasses if it's above 75. I can also set my look ahead. So here, I want to be warned if there's anything happening I should know about in the weather, not in the next hour, but in the next 2 days. And as you can see, when I reload the prompt, in the next 2 days, it's going to be, in New York City, it's going to be both too hot and too cold and too rainy. Thank you.
Next up, we have Assay. You're next. And after that, we have President Evil, Trumpocalypse, and Instai Etsy.
Can we swap Assay and Trump?
Okay. Doesn't look like you're quite ready, so we will do President Evil, Trumpocalypse. Okay, you did it.
Sorry.
Good job.
What do you need? It's HDMI. Please connect. Set up.
What we do? I've got everything from the laptop.
Yeah, and you can just pull up Visor to get your phone.
Yeah.
Here, I'm just going to take the boot. We can just swap
it's
here.
Like, it's my laptop. It won't take long, sorry. It won't take long.
No worries.
I've been traveling up and down the continent to attend hackathons. I'm from the UK. So, what's my problem? I care about my health very much, and I would love to understand how healthy is a city or a country I'm traveling to beforehand, and therefore I was inspired to develop a SAP. So, the solution is barely an Android app. Its slogan say, check out health in a city or a country. Using Essay, you can find how healthy specific city or country in the world by giving you the percentage of people who live there and suffer from contagious diseases, which is what we care actually about, if there's anything would affect us. So without any further ado, let's dig into straight the demo. So basically, that's the app to say. It's very simple. It's like this is the landing page. Are you traveling anytime soon? Wondered how healthy and contagious diseases are there in the city or the country you're traveling to? No worries, Essay will do the job for you. Just type in the name of city or country and we'll pull summarization of thousands of authentic and governmental data sets. So for example, if I write here DE, which stands for Germany, and check out, it will tell me 24% of the people that were entered in the survey suffer from contagious diseases. So you're at least aware of beforehand when you go there. And also, you could do UK, Great Britain, where I come from, sorry, what's this, actually 28%. So that was basic as this, the app where what I've developed. Maybe it's very simple because I would go through the struggles or the challenges that I've gone through here from the default submission. I had severe headache and exhausted body of mine managed to pull up working with decent logo because I ended up lost in the subway when I was trying to get myself down to the hackathon venue because
okay,
I'm not from here.
You're out. All right, good job. Give it up for President Evil, Trumpocalypse, followed by Insta Etsy, followed by BuzzPix.
You are!
Hi, I'm Sam,
that's pretty much the whole game. Oh, the fancy like life bars are your life. And
fight each other.
Yeah,
okay,
fight
yeah,
each
we'll
other.
Just fight each other.
Fight each other.
Wait, I can't see what's
it's
happening.
On here.
What? Oh, okay. Ready? Set. Oh, cheater. Sharp. That's it.
So where is that scene?
Oh, it's
yeah, we're like to try to. The eye is kind of silent. So where in Sayatsi, instead of the typical e-commerce site product recommendation algorithm that recommends things based on what you've bought in the past or what you've liked in the past on that page, we wanted to try to further personalize that and base your product recommendations on your Instagram likes. So what we do is we authenticate a user on the site, and then whatever they've recently liked, those pictures are given to the Clarify API. You get tags from the image recognition in that API based on your Instagram likes. So then those are fed into the Etsy API. Let me sign in real quick. I made an account, Mr. Heck NY. So right now, while it authenticates, those tags are given to the Etsy API, and then an algorithm that we made ranks them based on frequency, that over time those frequencies build based on what you're liking and what tags come up most often. So over time you'll get better and better recommendations, hopefully. And then you get a list of personalized listings from Etsy. Some of them are quirky, but so you get listings. We'll look for one that we like. And all right, so click on the link and you can go buy it. So that's in Sayatsi.
Monmouth University in New Jersey.
And I'm Mike Anastasio from Monmouth University.
So basically what we built, it's a very simple web page. We use the BuzzFeed API. So using a Python script, we grabbed out of the API all of the images from the feed, like you're just like the BuzzFeed feed, and sourced the images and kind of put them up in a grid. So it's kind of basically a more immersive visual way of looking at the feed. And basically you can just kind of like scroll through and it's going to give you what category it's in. So basically it's a simple little tweak that we did, and like this is Mike's first hackathon and I've never used Python before, so it's like all new to me. So very simple. So basically let's say you find something, you click it and it'll bring you to the article. So yeah, so basically just a new way to look at your BuzzFeed articles kind of more visually. So that's what we made.
Following couple of boats, we'll have Rome.
face. Alright, okay, here. Alright, what's up everyone? My name's Spike and I made a thing called Dope Pope. Turns out the reason the Pope visited the United States was to talk to me, his music consultant, about dropping a new mixtape. However, the Pope recently learned English, I believe, so his English is not so good. So what I did for him was I took all his old speeches and I kind of just like sat through them and put them all in a database and got the last word of every single thing that he's ever said in English, which is not that much, and got a bunch of words that rhyme together and then put that over In the Club by 50 Cent. All in like a robot's voice. It sounds awful. So my thing is just like this one really, really long command. So does anyone have anything that you want the Pope to rap about? I'm not gonna take suggestions. It's war. It's war. He's gonna rap about war. All right. Oh, fuck. It happens to everyone. All right, so it's doing a bunch of like nerdy stuff. It's like finding words that rhyme with war. Four more. It's like fetching a bunch of like stuff, doing MongoDB, whatever, whatever. That's not the cool part. The cool part is the Pope rapping. So give it some computing time. Magic is happening. Error not found. Error not found. Error not found. And now it's waiting. Now something magical happened. Okay, it made a file called doesthiswork.mp3 on my laptop. So we're gonna go to doesthiswork.mp3 on my laptop and pray it works. Actually, wait, let's read
it. Play it.
No. What? You want the people want what they want. Yes! So the Pope dropped this fire mixtape, all based on very holy scripture.
So usually an image is there to illustrate an article in BuzzFeed, but we thought that maybe the article could illustrate the images. So what we did is you give this the link to a picture that you choose, whichever one, and then it gives that to clarify. It gets the tags. Using the tags, it looks for relevant BuzzFeed articles and also a bunch of Wikipedia articles. On that, we train a language model. It's just a trigram. Let's back off. And with that, we generate what we think or hope is going to be a BuzzFeed article. And we put some images in between that we get thanks to Clarify. So it takes a long time, actually, more than we expected. So we have a bunch of examples.
So we trained this model on this picture of the pillow. And it took the tags it got out of that. And it took some training data that it got from BuzzFeed and Wikipedia. And it generated the title of After The for some reason. And then we're not really sure.
Yeah, BuzzFeed is still way ahead of us.
So it tries to come up with some text. The idea was to have it be in the style of BuzzFeed about whatever image we gave it. So that's why we got training data from Wikipedia and BuzzFeed. So we got some text in English, but it doesn't always make sense. So we gave it a taco and it came up with nutrition facts and some other outputs from David Penguins and the decided owls. Our hack. Today, businesses care a lot about ratings and the reputation. So we're making it easier to give a rating of a business or a location through our Pebble application. As you can see here, for, with our application, we can, at any place, query for a bunch of local places of interest. Go select there, and it will load from our backend MongoDB database using spatial data. And in here you can see a bunch of locations that you can view at. And then going into it, we can also be able using Pebble to give an upvote or downvote depending on how you like the place or not. But if you don't have a Pebble, we also have a solution for that. Take it away, Mighty.
So we didn't really have time to do a Pebble upvote thing, so we just threw kind of two of those spice onto this.
1 minute.
So basically, we just had like a toilet interface, so I do wow me, just list like a bunch of locations, give it a sec. Yeah, it's taking a while. No, it's probably just taking a while. But
yes.
Yeah. So it just has like a list of all the locations using, because toilet is able to give some area information from that. And if I do like, town, so if I do that.
30 seconds.
So you can see that upvoted by one. Yeah. So and there's also a downvote, but
you also
yeah.
Download. Yeah, this is our hat. Thank you very much.
My name is Fazley, and this is my friend Javier, and we're actually from Hunter College. So before I start, I actually want to ask everyone a question. How many road accidents do you actually predict happened in the last 30 days?
Well,
guesses.
Where?
In New York City.
500.
No, 32,000 to be exact.
30,000?
32,000 to be exact. I probably more or less, but around that number, yes. So our actually web app, actually enables you to locate all the data regarding all the accidents that happened. We can actually output it by borrow the number of accidents that we have. We can slide through the data. And as you said, check yourself before you wreck yourself.
Okay. So basically, when you come into our page, you have four different options. So it displays all the, I guess, vehicle collisions for the past 30 days. So you have the most common incident type, so it's unspecified. And the next is just driver inattention distraction. And okay, the borough, most collisions in boroughs, people injured, people killed by borough. Over here you could actually filter the incidents from the past 30 days. So if you want like from a specific day, you can say like, I don't know, September 9th and submit. And then it'll plot on the map where these collisions happened. And over here you get your information about get all the information of what happened on that specific day.
So basically, as you can see, we were displaying 10 data per page, and we actually have 74 pages. So approximately 740 accidents happened in one single day. So we actually, the purpose of this app is to raise awareness that, you know, safe driving is actually really important. So.
Yeah. That's it.
A little more about what they did. For those who don't know, we had some of the NYC open data available during our hack, as it is to everyone all the time, and we saw a lot of hackers do cool things with it. So everyone should check that out sometime. Cool. After this, we will have Rome, followed by the Hackathon Caffeine Counter, and UBuzz. Come on down and get ready to present.
Hey guys, my name is Matt. I'm from Stony Brook University. So Stony Brook people, what's a seawolf?
I'm a seawolf!
Okay. And like most social media adult millennials, I have trouble getting my homework done. So recently I started using the Pomodoro method, which it's where you work for 25 minutes and then take a break for 5 minutes. And I really like my fancy schmancy Pebble watch, but there really wasn't a good Pomodoro timer for that. And a Pomodoro timer is something where it'll time, you know, your intervals of working for 25 minutes, resting for 5 minutes. And in addition to that, it'll also keep track of your Pomodoros, or 25-minute intervals that you work, which is really cool seeing, you know, if you're studying all night, how much you've actually worked. So I built an app for that called Buzz Timer, because it buzzes your wrist when you switch between work and rest periods. And the way it works is you have your little timer on top, and then on bottom it'll tell you whether you're in a work or a rest period, so you know what you should be doing, because our devices need to tell us everything now. So you can press the center button to pause and unpause it. And it counts down from 25. For the purpose of the demo, I did 1 minute because I can't stand up for 25 minutes. And as you saw, it buzzed and switched to the rest period to show that you were changing the intervals that you were working. And in addition, you can also reset the timer. And the little dots show you how many Pomodoros you completed, so you can actually quantify how much work you've done or how much time you've spent on Facebook instead of doing homework. Cool. That's it. Go Stony Brook. Is it good for you? Can I jump on?
Screwed up my display settings. A semi-responsive website. So we all had a lot of caffeine this past 2 days, right? No? So basically what it is, it keeps track of how much caffeine you could consume in milligrams, and it's all based on one serving, assuming that you only have like one can of something or one cup of something, or the usual serving of, let's say, a Red Bull or a Keurig K-Cup. So if anyone wants to give me like how much Red Bull they had, or how much for the Keurig machine they had.
Five coffees.
Five coffees? All right, so you would increment, and then it will give you the how much milligrams you've had. So that was two, three. So you went over. the recommended amount? 4? 5? Do you want to keep going?
Yeah, let's have a 6th one.
We can keep going, keep going. And yeah, and so it has, it's usually the caffeine energy drinks I usually see at hackathons was the basis of the options I created, but yeah, it's just something to be conscious about as you're hacking. And that's my hack.
Everybody, I'm Jason, I'm from Rutgers.
I'm Sam, and I'm from Rutgers.
So we decided to go with what turned out to be the really original idea of making a BuzzFeed app, mixed with Clarify. So I guess Sam can explain what we do while I show you guys our first image.
Right. So basically, you take the URL of any single image, for example, this beautiful car, you put that into YouBuzz, and it will, using Markov and Clarify and all sorts of things, create a BuzzFeed article based around whatever image you put in. So this is 22 reasons vehicle donuts in prison after 9 automobile old and it.
So,
which
yeah.
is a really pressing issue nowadays.
Yeah, so it's really topical. So another one that we chose was this kitten, or cat, I don't know. And that generates something like this.
They're going back and kitten instantly terrified and brand cat is the feline. Really makes you think.
Yeah. Okay. And
then
so
of course
we can try that one more time. So that's all generated using Markov chains on a corpus of data from the BuzzFeed API, and we get tags about the image using Clarify's API, and then we weight it properly, and so we create this masterpiece. I guess we'll try one more. Amelia.
Amelia Clark, Cara Delevingne, and everyone. Did Taylor Swift will cat your kitten?
All right, guys.
Thank you
That's
very
all
much.
Hi guys, my name's Viral and this is Varun and we're also from Rutgers. And we created HackHub. It's the hackathon information portal. So the problem that we tried to solve was that organizers have a tough time communicating with hackers at their event. Yes, there are channels like Facebook, Twitter, Slack, but the problem is that organizers have to update each of them individually. So what we created is HackHub. It's the one place where it's the all-in-one communication platform where the hackers can get announcements about food, any updates, lost and found items, etc. You can even request mentors from the website and get schedules for the workshops and their locations. So let's look at the upcoming hackathons. Since we're from Rutgers, we're interested in HackRU, obviously.
HackRU
next weekend. So you can get a brief overview of the event, and then you can look at the actual hub of the event, where you can see overview, any announcements that the organizers would have pushed, the schedule for events, any mentors that there are, and then if there are any frequently asked questions that hackers would like to know about. And do you want to? That's basically it. Thank you.
Cube Catch, and then something I'm guessing is Rubik's Cats.
Yeah.
Yeah, elite.
Hey guys, I'm Mazin. I attend the University of Kentucky.
I'm Matt from Virginia Tech.
I'm from Raquel from the University of Louisville.
So our goal in coming here was to create an app that would help ourselves. And one of the biggest issues that we had in school was if you've ever taken Calc 3 or organic chemistry or anything, one of the biggest issues is really visualization of different 3D objects, and there really isn't really many tools given by teachers to help students visualize. So what we did was we kind of made a duct tape app of sorts where we get images from the user, upload those to the Vuforia database, while at the same time making links or making calls to Wolfram Mathematica through a protocol called Netlink, and then we export those files, upload them to AWS, and then retrieve those files with Vuforia when the target is seen. So this could be used by people making textbooks or teachers wanting to make more interactive worksheets, and hopefully get more people more interested in things like STEM. Thanks.
All right. Next up, we have CubeCatch, Rubik Cat, and Project Horus. After that, it would be great to insert Rome back in. They were quite a bit earlier. That would be all right with you, judges. Thank you.
CubeCatch.
We're next.
You're next.
Yeah.
Who did you say was next? Hannah, yes. Who did you say was next?
CubeCatch. CubeCatch, you in the house?
Is CubeCatch here?
CubeCatch, nope. All right, Rubik's Hat, come on up.
No worries.
Thanks for the song.
I'm glad that helps.
Yeah.
Hey everyone, my name is Ishmael and this is Jay, and we made a Rubik's Cube solver. So essentially what happens is, he's going to take a picture of the Rubik's Cube, send it over to me, I made the backend, he's going to send it over to me, and then I'll solve it and send back the solution to him. So,
yep, so just to talk a little bit about the user interface, there's six UI scroll, there's a UI scroll view with six views for those of you who are familiar with iOS. For any one of them, you can take an image. So this is just an example. Once the image has been taken, you can also select what side of the cube it is, dismiss that. Once you get to the end, once you get to the last page, you have an option to be done, and you can take a look at all of your views that you have. We also incorporated an imaging library, which we didn't end up using for the actual algorithm, but it's kind of cool to have, and then Ishmael can talk a little bit about the actual solving process of the cube.
Yeah, so the backend was written in Haskell, and the way it works is it's a brute force solver. So essentially, in every state, there are 12 moves you can make to get to the next state, which means if it takes 50 moves to solve the cube, that's 12 to the 50. So that's 12 to the 50 different states you generate. So it will generate a solution for you, guaranteed. It'll just take a few years, and you'll probably run in space. So for our test, we reversed it once and did that.
Yep, there we go.
Okay, Project Horus, are you with us? Excellent. You'll be followed by Rope, and then draw anything.
Is there HTML?
That's exactly what we have.
This is HTML right here.
Really not good resolution.
It's not. Wait, how do I duplicate this one?
Say Spanish, you want to see, oh, what's a banana? You just circle the banana. And there's no, it's
chocolate.
It's the best way to do that. Sorry, the screen resolution on here is a little messed up. I'm not sure why. On my computer. A big part of it is that you can go on this website on your phone and pull up the thing and use your live pictures from your albums too. So I'm trying to find the picture that we have. Okay, so here. So let's say I just took this picture like 5 minutes ago, and let's say I circled this computer. And there you go, technology, and then you can serve the crowd. And yeah.
Oh, we have Chrome, and then draw anything, and then for the hell of it. Oh, I get it. Okay. Is to sort of make an app that will
Wi-Fi that will give you Google Maps directions without using Wi-Fi or data. And the way we would do that is by transmitting everything through SMS. So what he's going to show you right now is our directions. We're going to go from Stony Brook to Penn Station, and we're going to send a request to Google Maps API through SMS. And it's going to come to our server and back to us, and we're going to do some, you know, loop arounds here and there, and parse that. We're going to minimize that output, compress it, middle out maybe, and somehow get it back on the phone like so. And this way, you have all your directions, left turn, right turn, returns on here, and how long it's going to take you to get back home, get wherever you want. We also integrated Uber with this, so you could say we pass your location through GPS to our servers. We're going to send an Uber request through the API, and it's going to tell you the different fares or rates for the cabs. That's the Uber. So capacity 4, I'm sorry, it's a little weird. For the judges, I can show you the app right in front of you after. But the Twilio API is sending us the SMS, and we can see the capacity, how much it's going to charge you for the Uber, and we also have weather if you want to take a nice stroll down back to your house.
Zero data, absolutely no data used. There's no data on this phone right now.
Yeah.
So.
It was just the streaming that wasn't working for us, and the app works, thankfully. Yeah.
Woo!
Next up, we have Draw Anything for the hell of it, and Laundry Time. Come down.
This isn't something I practice doing.
be practicing either.
Woo!
Yeah, okay, so, my name is Flack,
I'm Tim,
this work for Stony Brook University. What's a sea wolf?
I'm a sea wolf!
Come on, guys. So, international fishing laws say that depending on what type of fish you catch, there's a certain limit to like the size of like what you can take home and what you have to throw back. So if it's too small, you have to throw it back. But if you're like a one-man fishing operation out in like Southeast Asia or something, you have to have one guy holding a fish, another guy holding a tape measure, and like another guy running it down. And that's impossible for one person because people typically don't have six arms. So our idea was, this is a slab, you slap a fish on it, the webcam,
it's supposed to be a webcam, we didn't have a webcam,
yeah.
So this is a hack.
Yeah, so normally we'd be using a webcam and Raspberry Pi. But the idea is we're using Clarify custom training to figure out what type of fish is on the slab, and we're taking the pixel data to find out like how long it is, and it's supposed to instantly tell you like, well, whether you can keep the fish and throw it back. But we only got to the part where
yeah, so currently it was a lot of algorithm training, and right now we only finished it for catfish because it was very easy to tell what catfish was, and the length is still very, very experimental, so right now I'm going to take a photo.
Do it one more, because you're hanging the picture. It's very
sensitive. It's my birthday.
Yeah, it's 50 centimeters by like our scale.
Yeah, I know. If you have a fish like half the size, it's actually going to give you like 26. You're just going to get the coefficient right.
Yeah.
But it knows it's catfish. It knows it's catfish.
Followed by water and
wine, and followed by lights,
camera, location. Go, do it.
Hey everyone, my name is Tyler. Here we have Nick, Shahan, and Biggie.
Yeah, we're four Rutgers students.
Yeah.
And so I have a little bit of a story about this. 2 years ago, Sam Agnew made this hilarious hack that like went viral, and it kind of fell through because you didn't have enough money to put into Twilio to like keep the traffic going. So we kind of like revived it with our own kind of like twist on it. And
We got two numbers here, and the two numbers are very interesting to this. We got one HackNY alum and a parent of a HackNY alum. We're going to call them up, and they know they're going to be called, but they don't know who they're getting paired with. So let's see how this goes.
This should be interesting.
I'm going to try to refresh this.
The server's not going D.
You're up, okay? Yeah, the server's down.
You can do it!
Yeah, so,
using Twilio,
we call two numbers, and the two numbers both get a call from the same number. And you know, they pick up like, hello, who is this, right? And then a person picks up, hello, who is this? It's a bit of a confusing situation for anyone that understands like how kind of others are supposed to work. This is one of the cooler hacks that I had heard of, and I'd always wanted to kind of experience it, but just it being before my time put it out of my reach. And now I'm like excited to be able to give it a try as soon as the end hack is back up. Anyone? After this, we should have it up and running, and you should be able to check it by just going to phone.wtf, phone.wtf, or phone.wtf.com. We don't have Wi-Fi on our server. So.
The Wi-Fi went down temporarily.
Wow, that's a lot. Yeah, you got a
joke track?
No.
Okay, no jokes. Sorry, guys.
Have a good day.
next up, we have water and life,
I'm gonna leave straight away, but anyway, I'll check you. Phone. Okay, so you can just keep on the right here. Yeah. I try to stay as long as I can, but it's tough.
Hey everyone, I'm from Water NY, and I'm literally starting off with an entertainment app, but we're quickly talking about doing something that actually helps people make the city better.
Yeah, so our idea was we looked at New York City open data and we saw there were a lot of water complaints that weren't being addressed, or they were being addressed, but they weren't very specific. So we went out and got some samples from drinking fountains, dog bowl, Washington Square Park fountain, and tap water. And we wanted to see if there was a way we could make it more specific in their complaints.
Okay, so there is a very quick light down there. This is the light, you can get it. And this is the lens that you attach on your iPhones. And then this is a glass. And we're going to test it very soon. This is the 30th one. Okay, that's my problem. And this. And then we attach this line here. So it makes the light on. And we have to test some water. We're gonna turn off the iPhone app that we built. So that's the water from New York City. Wow, what's this? Okay, let's take a photo real quick. and we sent it to a server, and we got the the terabyte, and we got the, it has,
So in the meantime, basically what we're trying to do is help empower citizens in the New York City area to actually know what's in the water and report with more accurate detail the things that they're drinking, or smelling, or tasting, whatever that may be, so that the city can respond more appropriately.
So this is like from 0 to 1. 1 is the cleanest water you have ever had, and then these we combine with the New York City urban data. So you can see here, these are all the data spots. If you press it like here, we can get the location that we send photos on. For example, like this. Okay. And we can do report anyway. Yeah, thanks.
Hey guys, my name is Zayn Hamani and this is my partner Alina. We're both students from Western University in London, Ontario, so Canada. We decided to come to New York a day early since it's such a great city and explore a little bit. So we went to Central Park, Times Square, and we saw all these great attractions, and we realized that we've seen all these places before in movies. So we thought, wouldn't it be great to just search up a movie and see all the places that this movie was filmed? But wouldn't it be great to just see like a cool restaurant or a nice landscape in a movie and actually know where that is and maybe visit it once in one time in your lifetime? So if you type in any movie name you want and get the movie locations, in about 5 to 6 seconds, it's going to place a pointer at every place that this movie was filmed. So if you click this, it actually gives you the coordinates and the address of that movie. The reason, so now that we're in New York, why don't we use a movie name that was filmed in New York, like Godfather, maybe. So if you type in Godfather and get movie locations, it'll get all the places Godfather was filmed in around the world. And then we can go to get current location once it's finished loading and actually zoom in on all the places in New York that Godfather was filmed at. What's happening is that we actually couldn't find any database that has the locations of all these movies. They actually only have the cities, but we wanted the actual location. So we scraped articles off the internet and used text processing to pull the locations from each one of these articles, and then put that into Google Maps' API. So if we type in Wolf of Wall Street right now, on top of this, we'd actually get all the locations of Wolf of Wall Street as well. We can type in any movie name you want. It takes about 5 to 6 seconds. And you get the coordinates, you get the address, you get the postal code if it has one, if it's not like a landscape. And you can pretty much visit any one of these places that you'd like. So that's Lights, Camera, Location. Woo!
Occasion when they had the unhack hack day, and I made this hat, which has a display inside. There's a Bluetooth module right here connected to LoRa, which is connected to a display on the inside. Now, these are not insulated, and so right now it's not functional, but it was functional when it's connected to the computer. And what you do is you go to this app on the phone, which you type in the Bluetooth, which connects to it, and you type it in what you want to say, and it puts it on the screen. And further down the line, you can use that for the charades game where you put something on your head and you have to act it out. Or in the middle of New York City, you can use open data to be like, oh, there's a hurricane. And then everybody who has these hats, it would flash. And then you can see some kind of things going on. You have to be safe. And so those are two applications that can come feature with it. When I'll explain that and make it functional. So thank you so much.
Okay, we have Imagely, Speakify, and then Informant.
Hello, fellow hackers. My name is Anne, and these are my teammates, Theo and Thomas. In the past 20 hours, we have made language learning fun and accessible for everyone, including children.
Yeah, so basically, we use photos that will allow, and with Clarify and Yandex, that will generate a list of words in different languages. So say if you have a photo of the Apple Tower, it could be a list of English and Spanish and different other languages, like Russian. The template should be wider because of the pixel, so it all got pushed down and down and pushed down a little.
So this enables you to learn seven words, up to seven words per image, and it associates you with a visual cue, so it makes it easier to learn a word.
And for future plan, we plan to make this more practical by like specifically I'm working on making like a quiz mode. So it's more than Quizlet, so every time you enter your URL, it's going to save that image along with all the tags generated by Clarify. And we're going to store it into a MongoDB, and we're going to generate like quizzes, and because it helps with, because like retention learning is a very important part of language acquisition. So, yeah, that's what you can go with the tag after the hackathon.
Okay, nice. Next we have Speakify, followed by Inform, followed by Cowork 24.
Clarify is pretty cool. I know a lot of people here used it in their hacks, but this is a hackathon. So I thought, why not use Clarify to do voice recognition? So that's what I did. This is Adobe Audition, and so I set this up. I'm going to record myself, see if this works. Three. Let me try that one more time. Three. All right. Now take this recording that I just made, save it up. Over to my application, load it up. Let's see what happens. Now it's somewhat unreliable. We're lucky. Five! So, it turns out what I built is a random number.
Why are you uploading to Imgur?
Because Clarify's API needs a URL to look at to see an image.
Give it one more time.
All right, let's try one more time. I'll try this one here.
That's just all right.
Three.
looks quiet. Yeah. Set it out. So I generated over 200 spectroscopes for this. And all of it may be for nothing. We'll see. 7. Hackathons are all about failure.
That was wonderfully in the spirit of the hackathon. Next up, we have we have now Cohort 24, followed by PayPal Imitation.
No, sir. Yes,
that was your informant. Okay, yeah. That's what I thought. All right, your informant, followed by Cohort 24, followed by PayPal Imitation, and then Offscape. So we're going to introduce you all.
Hi guys, we're informant. I'm Steve from the University of Chicago.
I'm from UMass Amherst.
I'm Sylvester from Toronto.
And so we built informant with three goals in mind. The first was to just gain YouTube experience overall. The second was to extract as much data as we could from a video. And the third was to just look a little bit more deeply into kind of like the interactions that happen between parties and participants in a video play. And so I'm sure you guys all have had this problem where you can see somebody on the TV screen and you know who he is, but you can't quite put your finger on who he really, really is. So what we did was we used a computer facial recognition so that when a party appears, it'll try to detect his face, his or her face. So it's trying to detect somebody's face here. And the little magenta squares, if you press on them, then it should pop up a small little biography from Wikipedia about who they are. If you're going to give it a shot, and if it's trying to determine that he or she is more to be more Jimmy Fallon. The second part is that if you go scroll down a little bit, we have kind of like a transcript going on. It's kind of showing the intent between the two parties and what they're trying to convey to each other. And we use natural language processing to determine kind of like the sentimental analysis between the two parties and try to come at the end of your video, you can kind of see a conclusion of what the relationship between the two parties are. And that's informing.
Next up, we have Cohort 24, followed by PayPal, followed by Boxing.
So we from Cowork 24 came up with our idea because we just love co-working spaces. So co-working spaces are kind of like hackathons. A lot of very interesting people like you come together and work on their individual projects in a very creative and productive working environment. And we kind of thought to ourselves, why do we have to limit these co-working experiences to events and co-working offices like WeWork? So with Cowork 24, we want to create a mobile app that lets everyone create and find co-working spaces on demand wherever you are. Let's have a look. Let's say, for example, I have 2 hours now. I'm in the city and I want to work on my individual project, but I don't want to do it alone. So I create a co-work space and my favorite coffee close by. That's not true.
Can I do like a timer or something?
Just restart visor.
Restart visor.
Okay, I'm just going to continue. So it lets you create a co-work space like wherever you want to go. It could be a park, it could be a library, it could be a cafe that you want to go to. and you want to work on an individual project or like a hack, and you can invite people to join in. So it kind of tries to create this co-working atmosphere that brings all the people together and like work on the individual projects, being very creative to wherever you are. And you have the possibility to meet people you don't know and stay in contact with them and just learn a lot from these people. So let's say I want to find a co-working space. I can look by activity or by place, and I can look for a cafe close by. So I can find these are the co-working spaces, and whoa, that's Master Yoda sitting in one of them. So I just want to join him, and can have Google Maps navigate me to him. And with all this data gathered about my user profile, I can also get later on special offers from cafes in the areas where I go to in my favorite times in the week. And yeah, these special offers can be tied to my individual profile and preferences.
Anthony, you know I want to go to 31st Avenue and go in first Bussy Street, and I was wondering if you know about what type of taxi I can take, if taxi or Uber, because I don't know which one is cheaper, and I'm in a rush. I gotta be there in 4 minutes.
Sure. So our app actually does just this. We compare taxi and Uber prices. So how the app works is basically you input where you are currently, or what destination you are and where you want to go. And basically, what it does is, if you scroll down, location. So what we did was we used the taxi open data set that we got, and we actually processed 1 million transactions, and we stored that, we processed that using our studio, and we actually went ahead and put this in MongoDB. And then we took Uber's API, and we got their estimation price, and we compared it. And as you can see in the app, at this time, to get from where we are right now to First Ave, it costs $10.50 on Uber and $7.62 on taxi fare. So yeah, then we display this on our map. And yeah, I hope you can get to where you need to go.
Thank you so much. That was so much helpful. And then we're going to ones that weren't able to sign up on DevPost earlier. So the first one I have here is BruzzFeed. And then if anyone else wasn't able to demo and would like to try again or wasn't on the list, come on up and we'll try to get you in.
Hi guys, I'm also from Rutgers University.
Woo!
My name is Cosimo Buss, and alright, well, the app I made is called When Are You Free? Have you guys ever been in that situation where you're just hungry and you're sitting in your dorm room and you just don't want to go to the dining hall by yourself or get food?
Yes.
So basically, one way to get past that is use the Twilio API and just spam call your whole phone book and see you. So another way is
Wow.
Terrify API to generate a bunch of tags for a popular biz on Imgur. If you want to check out some of these yourself but don't want to wait for like 5 minutes, take a chance. See a random one. Take a chance. Seven Mammals, whose 2015 was more than 8 times. Just look at this. Oh my god. If you guys want to check this out,
okay, now we're going to have a couple of teams that had real hackathon demos up here. We have Phone Demo TF coming back up, and then a couple more.
Hey guys, part two. Thanks for having us back. So hopefully everything will be better this time. As you can see, we're going to call two numbers. And I'll explain to you a little bit of how this works as soon as the phone calls me. You're going to hear some fantastic Twilio hold music for maybe a few seconds.
Hello?
Okay.
Hello?
So, one of the parties has picked up the phone.
Hello, my child.
I don't know if you all recognize the voice, but this is, of course, Spike Raza. He's also known as...
Have you checked out my mixtape? How are you, my child? How can I bless you?
So I think that we've had enough of these.
Well, as
so,
you can see,
yeah.
This can run through the Twilio box.
That was
so,
my mom.
That was. an interesting thing, the original Sam just didn't have the willpower and wallet power to keep pouring Twilio credits into this hack. So what we've done is we've set up a little link with, Braintree, where you can donate and for $1, download the conversation. Oh, jeez. Okay, here we go.
Okay.
No, we're not. Okay, here we go. So for $1, you can pipe in and download a wave, I believe, of the phone call. Shout out to Twilio. So, 10 seconds. The wave is downloaded. Have a nice day, everyone. From there.
Want to be alone, they want to work together or like in the surroundings of other people, and we believe that being surrounded by smart people increases your motivation, your productivity to work. But at the same time, a lot of people are shy, so like it's hard to actually go and approach other people without knowing them before. So our app, Co-op 24, is a possibility for you to actually go to a place, a cafe, and go and join the table with other people who are productive and working on their projects and work together with them. That's it, right? So if I want to create a co-work myself in this area, I can open this app and just look for a cafe close by, for example, Cafe Cabana. If I open this one, I can have several settings. I want to hack, I want two people to join in, I want to start hacking right away. So I can start a co-work and share this one on social media to have my friends join in, or I can just skip this because I'm more interested in getting to know other people. The other alternative is to find a co-work space, and as we saw before, we can look by activity or place. I can find a cafe close by where I can find interesting people to hang out with, not to work on the same thing, but to work together on individual projects, just to be inspired by each other. And as soon as I click on navigation with Google Maps, the Twilio API will gonna send a message to the other partner saying that I'm gonna join in. So I can go there and join and work together with that person. At the same time, a lot of data is gonna be collected. Let's say every Sunday at 10 o'clock, I go in this certain neighborhood and go to a certain type of cafes. All this information is saved and can be used for special offers to be targeted particularly from me. So this is the idea of this. We're planning on integrating with MongoDB for all the data of the locations and try to increase the relevance of our apps. Thank you.
Your Google Calendar and your friend's Google Calendar tries to find out open spaces. It'll show you in as a block on who's free in a timeline sort of fashion. Like any great hackathon, my computer's completely frozen and crashed right at the beginning.
I think this one messed up.
I believe in you.
There we go.
Bye, I gotta go. And then
Also, if you have a really awkward one, let's say you're in a group of friends, right? And everyone's on their phone, and like no one's texting you, and you feel like a loner. Well, we have a solution for that too. It works.
When I was at my fellow, I interned at a small startup called Order In. And a quick note, They no longer exist, so that's just goes to show you get to real nitty gritty startup life. Now, as you all know, I work for Twilio because I've been here for the sponsorship aspect of things. But yeah, I work for Twilio now, and it's awesome.
Woo! I think I'd like to start with Kim, who will tell us a little bit more about her internship itself and also about the speaker series we had for a year.
Okay. Yeah, so I interned at Birchbox, and I actually did 12 weeks there. I extended my internship for 2 weeks after Hack NY like officially ended. It was really great. It was on, it's on 28th, so I just walked to work from where we lived every day, which was a really nice walk. I love New York, so it was really great every morning and then every afternoon. The people there were awesome. That was great. And the speaker series, so twice a week, Mondays and Wednesdays, we went to different places, and really cool, like, startup founders and VCs, people like that would talk to us. We talked to, like, the founders of Code Academy, founder of BuzzFeed, the Stack Overflow founder, like, a lot of cool people like that. It's really interesting. I learned a lot about startups. I knew basically nothing about startups before Hack NY, so that was really, really cool. And yeah, it's a great experience. Living with all the other fellows was amazing. Like, great friends that I see constantly. Yeah, they're all over the place. But yeah, Hack NY is great. Highly recommend it. You should apply.
By the way, the dorm that we keep talking about, it's on 14th Street between Broadway and 4th, so it's above that, or 3rd, I guess. That's above the Trader Joe's on 14th. So, right there, Union Square.
Union Square is a really good halal card.
The left most cart is by far the best. And, like, you can try all three, but that is the one.
Right now.
That's the one true.
Shots fired.
We can talk later.
Anyway.
I think one of the important things to mention that Kim touched on a bit about the speaker series is what a unique opportunity we get to have real conversations with the people we talk to. You know, everybody talks to us not just about their successes, like, you know, sort of an ad, but they tell us all about their failures and their struggles and really what it was like to go through their lives as startup founders and people in the tech community. And that makes it really real, and a lot of the fellows at the end of it write about that and how interesting that was. I think that's really special and something you get not at a normal internship. Cheryl, I think you were going to talk a bit about how people come to the fellowship and what your story is and people can know as well.
Yeah, so I came into Hack NY as a freshman, kind of applied on a whim because one of my best friends from high school was a fellow the year before me, Charles Carey. So in high school, we worked on web projects together, just like hacking on things and like putting them on Reddit or HN, and, like that kind of, like it was like 2011 or 2010. And so nowadays it'd be Product Hunt, and like I don't even know what you kids use. Like, I'm Reddit, okay. And so we did a couple of projects, and I applied as a design intern, or as a design fellow, just saying like, hey, like to build cool things, really like to build cool things, let me in, really like to use the marquee tag on S8, yeah, which is pretty cool. So that was my journey into Hack NY. Summer fellowship was amazing, like everyone else will say. But I'll say also that people come from all over, and the fellowship does not end when the summer ends and when your internship ends. It's really like building a community. You become part of now 5, there'll be 6 years, and 170 something fellows. You're right there with our mentors, Chris and Evan, which is already amazing. We have like a ton of connections, we all know Kung Fu. And like that's really the cool part about the fellowship. Like we all talk about Slack all day, we look at Left Shark, we talk about some other things. I am Left Shark. Yeah, like Hack NY has been fundamental in my development since 2012.
Cool. Sam, I feel like you've got a really great perspective on how it's what's in your life.
Yeah, so I'm not even joking when I say this, but Hack and Y seriously changed my life. Like, this fellowship pretty much made me who I am today. So I was a 2014 fellow. I did the internship last summer, and I got to work at a really small startup called Order In, and got to work on a big part of their product and just like do a bunch of stuff with it. And I like never grew more, like both technically and otherwise, in such a small amount of time in my life. It's definitely the best thing you can do in your summer if you're a college student. Like, if you're choosing between Hack and Y and some other internship, it's just like the community you get out of this is just so amazing. And some of my best friends I've met through Hack and Y, the people I still hang out with every day. I live with Manny. He was Hack and Y fellow my year, but we also went to school together. And I got to meet Richard Stallman, so that was cool. That was pretty cool.
So one of the bigger projects
we're
working on right now did was attacked by Chance, and it was part of an awful, awful thing, one of their raids. Then that was the winter before I got into Hack and Y, and then the first day of Hack and Y, the fellowship dinner, I had dinner with Moot. Yep. So that was pretty cool.
While we're on the subject of speakers, I don't want to put you on the spot, but did anyone have a favorite speaker when they were in fellowship?
My favorite speaker was definitely, and like I always make jokes about BuzzFeed, but Jonah Peretti was like my favorite. That was like my favorite.
Jonah Peretti's a genius.
He's a genius. So Jonah's not getting my job. So, like,
Jonah Peretti's.
Tell us what you liked about it.
Well, like, wait, sorry.
Why? What was so great about it?
Well, I mainly just like the back and forth between him and Chris. Like, say something that's valuable for him and why. Like, being able to see how companies work and how, like, to be able to see, like, a genius talk is something that's really valuable because you're kind of, like, sequestered in your own bubble when you start learning how to program and do all this stuff. And then, like, to finally be able to be, like, right in the nitty-gritty and to see, like, okay, like, you know, there's not some sort of, like, gate where Paul Graham gives you a pass. Okay, yeah, now you can be a hacker. Okay, here's the key. You know, it's very tangible, and I think that's really, really valuable thing about having a lot.
My favorite speaker my year was Joan Wilson, who's an angel investor and the wife of Fred Wilson from Unisco Ventures. She was incredible, basically talking about like what it's like being in the tech industry, like how all startups can kind of get ahead, like what she's looking for when she invests. So she doesn't invest in lifestyle businesses, for example, she's looking for fit, right? And also being able to talk to her and get like one-on-one mentorship and guidance and in her words, helped me navigate through the sausage waters of tech industry, like that's incredible. Like that's a verbatim quote from Joan Wilson. So that was amazing. Yeah.
I also really liked the Jonah Peretti talk, mainly because that was the only talk where it was actually Jonah Peretti and then Chris Wiggins, who's one of the co-founders. But like they just seemed like really old friends who just like made fun of each other the entire time. But they also gave us like good advice and talked about the industry a lot. But it was, I think, one of the more relaxed talks because he wasn't talking like just telling us his story. It was just like very casual. And that's what I really liked about the speaker series is it's really intimate and you can ask questions. And it's not like a lecture. It feels more like a one-on-one.
I mean, our speakers regularly spend a whole hour after their talk answering questions from their fellows.
I'm getting
ice cream with us. I mean, we sat in a circle with the Union for Adventures guys this summer for like 2 hours and just asked them things. They're always so nice about just letting you talk to them and hear their experiences and ask them anything and have an answer honestly. It was really great. What was your favorite?
Well, as I said, my favorite talk during my fellowship was one with Jonah. Not like less so because of the talk itself, but because actually Jonah and I had a conversation about MIT afterwards, because Jonah actually went to MIT for grad school. So he noticed my MIT class ring, and then he and I kind of just like hit it off for like 20 minutes basically.
And then eventually I kind of just ended that conversation with, Jonah, I would love to work at BuzzFeed and I would love to do sort of like data science, data engineering things. And then he was kind of like, oh, let me just forward you to like a new data scientist. So having that like really powerful like immediate first connection, like basically threw me down like their process to eventually just get hired at BuzzFeed. So yeah, I basically got hired at BuzzFeed because of Hack and Wire.
Because everyone said Jonah, I'm gonna pick two. I think my two favorites just this past summer, one of them was not an engineer. Lori Segal is a journalist at CNN, and she talked a whole bunch about like her perspective on the tech industry. She does a lot of these really in-depth articles and videos about people in the tech industry, and she understands it with this like really amazing analytical perspective. And she spent a whole lot of time telling us all about it, and letting us ask questions, and giving her perspective on the things that the technology industry needs to improve, and not just the things that are already really great. I think that was really inspiring, to see people who are part of the tech community, but not necessarily engineers, offer perspectives and give real advice to us as we grow into the startup community. My other favorite was Amin-Ra Mashariki, who is the head of data analytics for NYC. And he gave this great perspective on civic tech and how we can change the world with data, and how his team gets to work with so many amazing people and so much great data. I think I saw a lot of fellows that day realize that civic tech can be extremely cool and extremely cutting edge, and isn't just like boring government stuff. So I think that was really inspiring for a lot of people, and it was very inspiring for me. And it really sort of shows the diversity of talks we get to have. So those are my two favorites. How about you, Sam?
For me, I'm going to say, well, how about Victoria Richard Stallman?
Yes.
He's just wild. Hearing Richard Stallman just talk about the free software foundation, just, that guy's insane. But the one I like, think I got the most out of was Joel Spolsky. I think Joel Spolsky is like probably one of the wisest guys around when it comes to startup stuff. So like, hearing him talk about like Stack Exchange,
he's so candid.
Yeah, and he's really funny.
Yeah. We'd like to take a couple minutes taking questions about the fellowship, if anybody has any. I'd love it. Well, we'd all love it if you'd read our interviews in the back of the book, and read about the fellows that we had this year. We've got a map of where everyone came from, a bunch of stuff that they told us in their surveys about their likes and dislikes and their experiences. I think we have the fellowship's favorite foods of the year in there as well. We just got a bunch of fun stuff about this class of fellows and some of our previous classes. So you can learn a lot there. Any questions?
You accept international?
So we accept international students as long as they're enrolled at a U.S. university for that semester. We've had a lot of trouble with visa stuff, and as long as you're at a U.S. university right now, we definitely can't accept you. So.
What kind of people are you looking for?
Oh, that's a really great question. So when we look at applications, actually our alumni help review applications every time, because more than just evaluating you for an internship, we're evaluating whether or not you're going to be a great part of our community. So things we look for are, of course, technical skill, willingness and like eagerness to learn all the time in your life, and what we can learn from you as a community. So we look at sort of you as a whole person in your application, and the things that make you excited about building, your curiosity, your skills, and I think it does a good job. We've got such great people here, and I can imagine that a lot of you would really fit in well, so you should certainly apply.
I reviewed like 120 applications or something last semester, and like the main thing I personally looked for, I don't know if everyone else said this, but it was like what I looked at your projects and stuff, like the things you would build, like going to hackathons is cool, like maybe having like a research project is cool, like I pretty much look at what code you've done, what you've done with that, and what you've done for the community at your school or something like that, because like, you know, we look for people who are good technically and who can give better work.
Yeah. Right. Just like offhand, I think like a bunch of us organize things at our schools, we're just hackathons.
Right, important to be part of a community is really important, I think.
Yeah. We have like a bunch of the big hackathon organizers at Hack NY, we have a bunch of like the big technical clubs at like universities at Hack NY, like Tech NYU or ADI, NHACS,
Hack RU,
YHack, Brown.
Yeah.
Really just saying words.
We're just saying words.
Hack GT.
Hack GT.
Which
are happening right now.
At Texas, which are competing with us, yes. Because suckers.
Okay. And you can get involved in all sorts of ways. Like, a lot of people get involved with their communities by, you know, mentoring others or contributing to open source. You don't necessarily need to be like a huge extrovert or anything to be a part of our community. Just showing that you want to be involved is
okay. And that you have, you're interested in.
Right,
and that makes. And I think also a big part of it, you know, the program is called Hack and Why, right?
Yeah.
A big thing that I was looking for when I was reading applications was, I was remembering a piece of advice that I got from one of the design people at Tumblr, mentioned there, was that it takes a certain kind of crazy to want to move to New York.
It's the greatest game.
So, for me, it's kind of a good one at that point. I'm basically kind of looking for that crazy
right.
In your applications.
You have to have that
very special place.
Yeah,
and
your work is weird, man.
Yeah, it's great. I think one thing we should mention about New York is how interesting it is as a tech place. Even, you know, I would say a lot of us would say even compared to Silicon Valley, because for one thing of how interdisciplinary a lot of our tech is, how we're involved with all sorts of other industries and this, like, you know, really old culture of building and making things.
Yeah.
So I think, yeah, New York all the way.
Yeah. Yeah, you have to be like a serious New Yorker kind
pretty
of
much.
Like want like a wannabe.
What about
Code
Academy guys actually said in their talk when we talked to the founders of Code Academy, they said like that when they did YC they just flew back to New York after they were done because they were like, our startup could not exist in Silicon Valley.
Yeah.
So I think we'd like to probably move on to our sponsor. One more.
How do you pair interns and startups? Like, how do you make
that
work out?
Oh, that's a very, very good question. So when you apply, we get a whole bunch of information about you. We learn about your technical skills, the kind of startup you'd like to work at. We ask you about some startups that inspire you so we can get more of a sense of like who you are and the kind of place you'd like to work in. And then the startups also apply, and they tell us what kind of students they're looking for, what their skills would be, more about their philosophy. And we try to match you not only technically, but in terms of your attitudes about life, your philosophies. It's a really huge and insane process, and it's been really successful. So you get matched after you're accepted, and we later call you up with a match, and you can talk to each other and figure out if it's a great fit. It's been really awesome.
Some of us actually chose our own. I actually chose one of my startups because I talked to them outside it, and I was like,
that's
hey,
a good point. If you
hey,
are,
can I intern for you and be your Hack and Why fellow? And then I kind of just made them and Hack and Why talk.
Right. No. Occasionally, some people do already know of a New York startup that they'd like to work for, and sometimes it just works out. You know, they would like you to work for them, and they'd also like to have a Hack and Why fellow. So if you have an idea of your own and there's a startup you'd like to work for, that's totally welcome. We really should switch to sponsor prizes. I'm so sorry. So we have some sponsor prizes coming up. Thank you again, alumni, for coming up.
Yeah.
All right. If you are giving an API or sponsor prize, it would be great if you would come down so we can go through them. We've seen so many great hacks, and we are ready to go.
Sarah and the campus recruiter at MongoDB. Great job to all of the hacks that used Mongo. The winner is Incalculator.
Oh. Yeah.
Back
there.
Oh,
you
I'm
Oh, so he wins an Amazon gift card and also a chance to go to Monzo TV World.
I guess I told the other people to use Monzo?
Yeah. So all of the hackathons that we are sponsoring this year, all the winners and the best use prizes are going to be a list together. We're going to send out that list to the Monzo TV employees and have them vote on their favorite hack. And then that will be more invisible. We'll get a trip to New York to and then also for those of you looking for internships and full-time roles, we're hiring for software engineering interns and full-time engineers in our New York City office. It's a great program. We have many Hackaday fellows come and join us. We also will be looking for fellows for this upcoming summer. If you have any questions, kind of over and back, feel free to come up and ask me.
All right. Next up, we have a prize from Dedo.
Hi everybody, I'm Tom Kabuti. I'm a software engineer at Dedo.
I'm Brian. I'm also a software engineer.
And we have a prize today for the most Rube Goldberg-esque app. And for that prize, that is the app that did the simplest thing in the most number of steps. And for that, we are giving an Amazon gift card for $318.46. And the winner, what's the current machine?
Best User Twilio Prize is going to go to the Rome team.
Oh.
guys is wearable sleeping bags that I think you should bring to like any other hackathon you go to. It's a sleeping bag you put on your body and wear.
The body.
And he's too tall.
As good as me. Congratulations. the last
part of that. Sorry. Last one for now. I'll be back later putting medals on people but not talking. The best domain name, and this is according to Carl. Carl has been like helping me. Carl and Jade have been helping me all this weekend. And they have picked bra.com.
Co.
Bra. Bru. Now I yield the floor.
Sure, all right. Our final sponsor award, or API award in general, comes from the most creative hack that started from a Springboard project. And the Springboard project came from a hackathon is here to tell you all about it. And if you have.
Hey guys, this is Addy, John, and I'm Caleb, and we're just here from the on Hackathon, which you might have saw over there.
So the reason they came up with the Springboard project was that we saw at hackathons a lot of people sort of struggling when they came, especially first-time people or people that didn't, you know, have teams, and they would come in and they would be like, I don't know what to work on, I'm just going to give up and Facebook all day or whatever. And we really wanted to make sure that everyone had a chance to work on a project and everyone had a chance to learn. So we came up with sort of a list of projects, which are the Springboard projects, where people could just, if they didn't know what to do, they would get started on one of those and hopefully they would get inspiration and be able to work the entire time and make something awesome. So basically, this time around, I think everyone that did them were all either new or they didn't really have an idea when they started and they got some, and we think that's really cool. And in particular, there was one team that really did very well, and not only did they sort of finish the project and I think learn a lot about general synchronization and all that stuff, but they also really took it far with the design. They took it and they made it, you know, much better, much nicer looking. They added features and they made everything sort of just look great and work great. And they basically were looking for that kind of creativity when someone is presented with starting, they hope they find something. They figure out everything out. So they just did amazing. And Addy will present the prize for them.
So the prize for them is instant happiness, which we call Chipotle gift card. $25 gift card, so they can go for a really per hour, so they can go for a really nice burrito party after that. And the winners are Draw Anything.
Going to be able to
tell us a lot about why they won and why they're so great. Our first prize is the Eighth Breaker, which is a prize that goes to a hack that goes outside of the conventional hackathon project. And here to present it is Minerva Tantoko, the CTO of New York City.
Whoa. So the Eighth Breaker, as you know, is sort of something we haven't seen before, and judges chose this one because it was so interesting in terms of how it actually generated data to present on the app. So the winner of the Eighth Breaker is Camera Lights Location. Woo!
So
you probably don't even know what time it is either, right? Either way, one of the really impressive parts of this particular hardware hack is that they started out with broken hardware. They meant to not only fix it, but make it better. So this goes to the current machine.
Woo!
Shark, when do you not win?
Are you still in school?
Alright. Our next award is for the best first hack. So if this is your first hack call and your first hack, this might be a free award for you. It's going to be presented by Christina, the founder of Bridge Up at Bridge Up STEM at the American Museum of Natural History.
We're working on brand recognition ourselves. This particular award, it goes to a team who we thought solved a real problem, had a user interface that was easy to use, and it actually worked come demo time, which is impressive in any hackathon, but it's certainly impressive for a first-time team. NYC Vehicle Collision.
Woo!
Our next award is an award that was not in your field guides. You've never heard of it before. Our judges were just so impressed by one of the hacks that they created an award in this category. And here to present the best civic tech hack, again, is Minerva.
I'm biased because I'm, you know, the CTO for New York City, but, you know, hacking is it's very important. It's a superpower, and you want to use your superpowers for good and use it to help improve the lives of people around you. And so we created the Civic Tech Hack Award, and it goes to WaterNY.
Okay.
Okay, then you get 3 seconds to run away from the ball, because that ball is going to come at you.
Direct.
It's going to run away, but then you get more points as you run away. So the more you run away. I thought I should show you my database. Very complicated Boolean database. And it uses in the construction if-then. So there's some if-thens to work out, and there are 3 whole variables needed.
This is a variable for game on. Okay, Tyzo, any other tech you want to talk about in this demo? Thank you very much.
Our youngest hacker at this hackathon. So without further ado, our final three award-winning hackers. So runner-up for third place is Project Horus. Yeah. Thanks again to the sponsors, the volunteers, the judges, the technical ambassadors, And most importantly, all of you. Without you, we couldn't do this.
Hey! If you're riding the Mongo DB bus home, it's supposed to be here at 3:30, so don't miss it.
Right outside.
No food for you guys.
I'm going to do the first one.
job, guys.
Yeah, they don't get too fast.